women's disease in particular, and this is called systemic lupus erythematosus. So lupus is a disease that has no cure. It affects about 40 to 200 women out of every 100,000. It causes multiple problems, including cardiovascular problems, but primarily it affects the kidneys and the skin. It's diagnosed by something called a wolf-like rash, which is why lupus is the name of the disease, lupus being the Latin word for wolf. It gives this red rash on the cheeks. And if any of you, all of you probably know someone who has lupus or has that wolf-like rash, even if they haven't told you they have lupus. It's actually quite common. And in fact, my own mother passed away from complications associated with lupus. So it's a very devastating disease. And I ended up living with it for about 26 years, watching my mother suffer with this disorder. It primarily affects women, and it manifests primarily in women in childbearing years. So you can imagine then that many young women are suffering with these particular diseases. We, several years ago, came across, so I've been studying, I mentioned Noonan syndrome earlier, we've been studying these pediatric disorders called Noonan syndrome and Noonan syndrome with multiple antigenies for multiple years. These kids have devastating features. I don't want to go into a lot of the details, but they're very similar. They have craniofacial abnormalities, skeletal abnormalities, and cardiovascular defects. But several years ago, it came to my attention that these kids were also developing lupus, which is likely to not be coincidental. And so we, you know, over 20 years worth of work, we discovered that many of these kids are, the cause of this particular disorder was genetic mutations in one particular enzyme called SHP2. And so we hypothesized, is it possible that this particular enzyme, irrespective of having Noonan syndrome, is also causal to autoimmune disease? And so we started to look at this a little more carefully. And to date, I can tell you about 50 cases of patients with Noonan syndrome also have lupus, which a rare, unrare disease is actually not rare. So it means that it's definitely related. So when I was at Harvard, down the hall from me was George Tsokas. He's one of the world's experts in lupus. And I approached him about this problem, and he became really intrigued by it. And first, you know, kind of said, well, I don't know, it's not an immune cell enzyme, so I'm not really sure how this is going to be related. But why don't you take a quick look? He shared some of his lupus mice with us, and we found some remarkable observations. So we also collaborated with a group in who's now at Purdue. He's a true biochemist, Zongyang Zhang, who helped us develop an inhibitor specifically for this particular enzyme. Noonan syndrome is caused by gain-of-function mutations, which means too much activity of this enzyme. And so if we inhibited it, we thought that we could perhaps prevent or treat or reverse lupus. And so using this particular drug, we then treated animals with this particular disease. And I just want to show you quickly, the lupus mice are white, which is what the color makes no difference. So the control mice are black here. This is just in the absence or presence of the inhibitor to show that the inhibitor had no effect on these animals in general. The MPJ mice here in the middle are also background control for the lupus mice. We wanted to make sure that the mice that have the same background lupus had no effects in the drugs. You can see no effect in the absence or presence of treatment with the drug. This particular mouse here is a lupus mouse. You can see severe skin lesions in those animals, similar to what you expect to see in the patients that have this particular disease. And this is a littermate mouse from the same colony treated with the 11A1 inhibitor. Substantial improvement in the overall skin lesions of these particular animals. When we look here, there's no drug toxicity in the animals treated with the inhibitor. And when we actually look at a Kaplan-Meier curve, which shows you the death rate of these animals, all of the lupus mice died by 26 weeks of age. We only had 20% of the animals die in response to the treatment of those same cohort of animals, suggesting that inhibition with this particular enzyme can in fact have profound effects on preventing this disease from progressing. We also looked at the kidneys in these animals. This is a lupus kidney. You can see grossly enlarged here. This is the same kidney from the littermate that's treated with the inhibitor, which is almost normal. One of the hallmarks of an autoimmune disease such as lupus is loss of protein in the urine. Many of you may have heard this in other kinds of kidney failures and glomerulonephritis type of disorders. This is the kidney from a lupus mouse. This is the lupus kidney from the mouse treated with the inhibitor, almost completely normalized. So it suggested to us that this inhibitor had some significant effects. And I think with the lighting, you may not appreciate here, but I mentioned before the fibrosis in the heart, which is the blue area that's stained for that dead tissue in the heart. This is the kidney tissue stained for the fibrotic or dead area in the kidney, and this is the litter mate that's treated with the SHP2 inhibitor. You can see a dramatic improvement in the overall kidney function in those particular animals, again suggesting we can reverse this disease. But what we discovered was that this inhibitor actually worked only on one component of this molecular signaling pathway. So there are two mechanisms that lead to lupus that we at least understand at the moment. It's still unclear how one develops systemic lupus erythematosus. I should tell you that up front. But what we think are both the B cells and T cells are involved, and those are your immune cells in the body that become activated in response to disease or even an infection in the body. And that this inhibitor only blocks one component of that, which is the T cell. So we're not quite at a cure, is what I'm basically coming back to. And we're still in the process of really trying to identify ways that we can reverse or treat this disease. And perhaps using two inhibitors, one that blocks B cells and one that blocks T cells, may be a therapeutic approach that we would might want to think about going forward. But this is definitely an area that we're currently investigating. And I'm proud to say that the Order of the Eastern Star, if any of you are members in New York State, are actually making this their primary research project for this year.